Well, good morning, saints. Good morning. And good morning, sinners.
Good morning.
Okay, a few more of the latter than the former. The astute of you have noticed that I am not Pastor Michelle. Yeah, my name is Mark Marino. I'm a retired pastor, retired from this congregation, and happy to be living out this part of my ministry here. Pastor Michelle, many of you know, was on a trip to India, arrived the week before last, and she and a number of her companions were not allowed into the country for reasons that we don't fully know yet. But they were detained for a while, then returned home. Just a grueling, exhausting trip, just physically, mentally, emotionally. And since she had planned not to be here anyway, she thought it best to take the week to kind of recover, in addition to which she caught a horrible cold as a result of being planes and airports and all that. But she is looking forward to being back with us next week to guide us through into the Advent and Christmas seasons, and she'll be able to explain to us more of what happened. So we'll ask continued prayer for her. In welcoming you to worship, I did want to call attention to the volunteer interest surveys that were distributed last week. We do have some more of these, so if you didn't get one last week or you didn't have a chance to fill it out and you want to, they're in each of the vestibules and there are some boxes labeled for you to put them in. There is something for everyone in this church. Anyone who has a gift or a grace who wants to use it, there is a way. And if it's not listed on any of the options here, on the very back page, there is some blank space so you can write it in. And I hope you will. So we have a full service today, lots of music and some other good things for us, and looking forward to a wonderful time of worship. And welcome.
And good morning again, Central Church. For those of you who are visiting with us today, we're glad to have you here. And for those of you who are watching on television, we're glad that you're participating in that way as well. Just a couple announcements. First off, if you are sitting in the aisle, please pick up and sign the maroon-colored friendship pads that are next to you. Pass them down so you know who you're worshiping with today. I'd like to start announcements with one-minute speaker, Maggie Hungerford.
I heard a rumor that Captain Underpants was here last week. Is that true? Well, since Captain Underpants has been around and about this church, we've had no signs of the boxer brief bandit. But we still need your help to replenish the underwear supply at the clothing center. So if you would, there are tags to my right and to my left and down the education hallway as you leave. And I also have a challenge for you. If we get enough pairs of underwear and load up our two laundry carts, maybe, just maybe, Captain Underpants will appear again next week for Undie Sunday. Thank you.
Thank you, Maggie. Just a few announcements that I would like to highlight. All of our announcements are in your bulletin, so please check for those and additional things that are going on at the church. The first thing I'd like to point out, which is not in the bulletin this week, that our Thanksgiving dinner is coming around, and there are lists up in the Welcome Center for assistance for preparing the dinner and the dinner itself, and also for food donations. So if you're interested, please sign up for one or as many as you'd like. Our blood drive is this upcoming Saturday, November 3rd. We're still looking for volunteers for that. And also, Saturday, November 3rd, we're having our trivia night, sponsored by the Fellowship Committee. That will be at 6 p.m. It's cover dish and trivia led by Bruce Bishop. So please come. It should be a fun night. Now, next Sunday is All Saints Sunday, so the congregation is invited to bring a memento of a loved one to the service to place on the altar and place it on the altar prior to the service. And today is our 2 cents per meal deal donation for Shepherd's Supper, our Thursday night meal. The collection will be available at either door at the end of the service. Now, for any other information, again, please check your bulletin. If anybody has any questions about anything that's going on at the church, contact the church office. And everybody is welcome to any event at Central at any time. So won't you please join me in the responsive call to worship, which is printed in your bulletin and on the screens. We gather today to praise God who created all things, cares for us tenderly, and calls each of us to a life of service and ministry. We also gather today to confess our failure to be the people God has created us to be.
We take for our grace. guys. Well, before we get into this, look out there. What's out there? What do you see when you look out there? No. What do you see right here? You see a window. What do you see? People. That's right. Everybody out there is a person, right? And everybody here is a person. Everybody back there is a person. So that kind of makes us all alike. Well, you know, you look at these rocks. What are they?
Stones.
They're all stones, aren't they, or rocks? They're stones or they're rocks.
I like stones.
So, in lots of ways, we're all the same, just like nature is all the same. But look at those stones. Are they all the same?
No.
No. What's different about them?
Shape.
Shape?
Color.
Color? Put it down, please. Put it down. Later on, you can look at them. What? Size?
Weight?
Mm-hmm. That's right. They're all the same, but they're all different. You're doing a good job. You're teaching me. Now let me show you something else. My husband and I were what you call rock hounds. We used to go hunting rocks. Now, isn't that the silliest thing you ever heard of? Sure, you can have a hug. There you go. Okay, now you know, that sounds pretty silly to go hunting rocks, doesn't it?
No.
But I love rocks because they tell me different stories all the time. Now you look at this rock.
Whoa.
Oh, it's you wouldn't think anybody would want to pick that up. That's just it's an old, oh yeah, would you?
It's an asteroid.
Yeah, it's just an old ugly rock. You know what they call that? They call that a thunder egg. And there's nowhere you can find those, they tell me, except in Arizona. And that's where that thunder egg came from. We dug and we dug and we dug. And this is what we found down there. So over hundreds of years, God just fed this. Went down what they called fissures, which is just a straight line. And all the chemicals and the dirt and all kinds of things came down on it. And over hundreds of years, maybe thousands of years, it formed this rock. Ugly, right?
No.
Yeah. Well, it's not the pretty. You look at some of those. Those are pretty. Right?
These are pretty.
Yeah, right. Okay. Okay. Let's put them down. Let's put them down to late. Well, let me show you something. Because after we got these rocks and hunted them, we did something to them. We polished them, and we cut them, and see what happens? So that's not so ugly inside, is it? That is kind of beautiful inside. You know, it looks like Jupiter. If you say so, I'm not quite sure what Jupiter looks like, but if you say so, that's great. Right, right, and it's shiny. But see, God took this thing and he made the inside beautiful. That's what he does to all those people. That's what he does to all of us. He teaches us things that makes us beautiful inside. See?
I like that.
Whoa.
It's a crystal. I saw that one in the bath.
It's kind of like the same thing, but it got cut up again. It's a different shape.
I like this one.
Yeah, right. That was cut, but then also there were some small cuts, and that's different on the side. Now, this one doesn't look like much on top, does it? Look on that. But look at, if you look at it sideways, what does it do?
It sparkles.
It's all sparkly, isn't it? And look at this one. You had to look to find that treasure. Yeah, see that treasure. So you see, God has made all this for us. And God has filled us with lots of things. But does he want us to keep those things inside?
No.
What does he want us to do with them?
He wants us to leave them outside.
And what? How do we do that?
We say kind things.
What? We say kind things. What else do we do? What else do we do? We show them love. What ways can we show them love?
By sharing.
By saying thank you when somebody does something for you.
By saying thank you. Those are the things. That's the way we tell others about Jesus and about God. We love so much what God has done for our insides. We want everybody to know that these things come from God and from Jesus. Can we have a little prayer? God, we thank you for making us different. Can you repeat? God, thank you for making us different and giving us gifts that we can give away. Because we want everyone to know that you love them. Amen. Okay, I'm going to give these to Miss Kelly, and you can follow Miss Kelly out, and you can choose one of the rocks for yourself, okay?
Jesus was a miracle.
first scripture reading for this morning comes from the book of Psalm, chapter 34, verses 1 through 8, which can be found in your pew Bibles in the Old Testament, page 508. I will bless the Lord at all times. God's praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. O magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt God's name together. I sought for the Lord, and the Lord answered me and delivered me from all my fears. Look to God and be radiant, so your faces shall never be ashamed. This poor soul cried and was heard by the Lord and was saved from every trouble. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear God and delivers them. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are those who take refuge in God.
Good morning. So most of you know me, but for those of you that don't, my name is Kelly Crane, and I've served as the Director of Education and Programming for the past 2 years here at Central. Before that, I was a coordinator in the Clothing Center and helped with our Shepherd's Supper meal. Michelle asked me to speak today about what Central means to me and how Central has helped me grow in faith and discipleship. I wasn't really sure where to begin. Before I came to Central, my faith life was rather complicated. I was working in a newspaper industry, so getting to church on Sunday was not possible. I've mentioned in other messages that I've given here on Laity Sunday and UMW Sunday that I'm a recovering Catholic, and my experience in the Catholic Church always seemed to be centered around guilt. The only reason I even stumbled into Central 6 years ago was because I left my job at the newspaper, so I didn't have a good reason anymore for not being able to come to church. So my guilt and my sense of obligation are what brought me through the doors, but the love and grace of this congregation are the reasons that I stayed. And don't get me wrong, it didn't happen overnight, but it did happen. Today, I'm standing up here a completely different Christian than the one that walked in here 6 years ago. My choice to join a Companions in Christ small group study changed my relationship with God. Today, I know and understand the grace of God. Today, I know that even though I'm not perfect, God loves me anyway, and I can't do anything to earn that love. He just gives it to me. Today, I know the joy that comes from serving others and not out of a sense of obligation to earn God's love. And today, I know that God has a plan for me. I know these things because of this church. I have truly been blessed to be on staff here at Central and be able to serve this church and this community. This place has never, ever felt like a job to me. I have loved every single minute that I have been here with all of the people that I have worked with. So as many of you know, my time here at Central is coming to an end. My husband has started a new job in Savannah, and I'll be joining him in December to start the next chapter of my life. And as hard as it's going to be to leave this church, I promised I was going to get through this. I'm forever grateful for every moment that I've spent here. Because of Central, I have friendships I hope are going to continue on despite the distance. I've experienced small group studies that have grounded my relationship in God, and which in turn has challenged my faith and has shaped my faith. Central has allowed me to realize my own call to ministry, and although I'm still wrestling with what that path is going to look like and where that path is going to lead me, I know this church is going to have my back through it. I know many of you have already heard me talk so many times before about the Colossians 3:12 in past messages. I have this verse on my business card. I have it on my mirror at home. I have it in my car. I've used this on our mission trips with our youth, so I'd be remiss today if I didn't mention it again. In Colossians 3:12, Paul writes, "As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience." I think this verse summarizes how I see Central as well. These are all outfits that you all wear every day. I've seen every one of them. It truly has been an honor and a privilege to work and to worship alongside each and every one of you here at Central, and I truly can't wait to see what God has in store for this church.
Let us pray. Redeeming Lord, we continually seek your comfortable refuge. You deliver us from our unfounded fears and provide us with miraculous examples of your love. In response, we offer these gifts. We pray that these funds will provide an outreach that warms people with your resplendent love. As a church community, we exalt and praise your holy name. Amen.
Many of you did over the this last week. I followed with, I'm going to use the word amused interest, the bonds that were sent to various people around the country and discovered. And I use the word amused because they didn't go off, nobody was hurt, and I was very confident that the law enforcement officials would be able to quickly find out who it was, because these people usually are not very bright. And indeed, it appears that that's what happened. So as the week went on, I was feeling pretty good, and I remember thinking, you know, this is good that it didn't turn into a real tragedy. And then came yesterday in Pittsburgh. I haven't had a chance to look at the news this morning. The last I heard, 11 worshipers were killed, and how many others were injured? And how many others just psychologically now having to deal with this trauma? A rabbi colleague of mine in Binghamton has a friend who's a rabbi in Allentown. And the rabbi in Allentown wrote it's called a Havdalah prayer. Havdalah is a Jewish religious ceremony that marks the symbolic end of Sabbath and ushers in a new week. So she wrote this prayer and used that with her congregation yesterday. I got up this morning and decided that I would not use the prayer I had intended, but will instead use this one in honor of our brothers and sisters who are dealing with this horrendous tragedy. Blessed are you, Adonai, our God, ruler of the universe. Adonai who gives and takes. Adonai who distinguishes between the holy and the profane. Adonai who gives us confidence and makes us unafraid. Help us, Adonai. Answer us, O Sovereign, when we call. Grant us the blessings of light, of gladness and honor, which the miracle of deliverance brought to our ancestors. We raise the cup that elevates sanctification, not the mundane. We inhale the fragrant spice of sweetness, not sadness. We see the flame on our palm, creating the shade between enlightenment and hate and fear. Adonai, please allow us to see, to understand, to be a part of the good in this world. and grant that the families of the Tree of Life congregation no more sorrow, but rather abundant peace. Praised are you, Adonai, who guides us, showing the difference between the profane and the holiness. We lift up all those persons whom we have already named and are listed before us this day, for persons anywhere who need your presence, who need your healing, who need your strength. We pray, O God, for those whom we name out loud at this time. May these and all persons be touched by your healing spirit and by the gift of our presence as we pray together the prayer that Jesus our Lord taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The second scripture reading today is from Mark 10, verses 46 to 52. Hear the message. They spent time in Jericho as Jesus was leaving town, trailed by his disciples and a parade of people. A blind beggar by the name of Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, was sitting alongside the road. When he heard that Jesus the Nazarene was passing by, he began to cry out, "Son of David, Jesus, mercy, have mercy on me." Many tried to hush him up, but he yelled all louder, "Son of David, mercy, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped in his tracks. "Call him over." They called him. "It's your lucky day. Get up. He's calling you to come." Throwing off his coat, he was on his feet and came to Jesus. Jesus said, "What can I do for you?" The blind man said, "Rabbi, I want to see." "On your way," said Jesus. "Your faith has saved and healed you." In that very instant, he recovered his sight and followed Jesus down the road.
May God's blessing be on the reading and hearing of both of our scriptures this morning. I'd like to share with you two stories. They're a bit long, so I'm going to ask your indulgence. My intention is that the stories will actually connect with each other and ultimately connect with Scripture, and beyond that, hopefully, for us for the week ahead. The first story I call the Sally story, and I call it that because that's not the name of the woman, and I don't think there's anybody in the congregation with that name, so it's kind of a safe one to use. And it happened several years ago. It was before we came to Central. It was a young woman who had been a youth in a youth group in one of my former churches. And she invited Suzette and me to her wedding at the Silo restaurant in Green. If you've not had a chance to go to the Silo restaurant, just a beautiful, beautiful setting in the countryside, an old, remodeled barn into a restaurant on a lovely hillside. And they set the chairs on the hillside with the trellis, you know, where the wedding takes place. And you sit in the chairs and you look beyond where the couple will be and the rolling hills. And it was an absolutely stunning, sunshiny day, but not hot in the summer. And about 15 minutes or so before the service was to start, the groom, who I knew, motioned to me, called me aside and said, "Can you help us?" I said, maybe. What is it?" He said, "Well, the justice of the peace isn't here yet, and Sally is getting nervous. Can you do the wedding?" Well, my first thought was, for Pete's sake, I don't have any of my stuff. I mean, I don't have the book of worship or the hymnal with the ritual. I mean, I've got nothing. But I didn't say that to him. I said, "Well, I don't know. Let's go find out what the deal is." So he took me up to where Sally and her attendants were getting ready, and the bride was nervous, as they always are, but she was especially so. And I said, "What's going on?" And she said, "Well, the justice of the peace isn't here, and by now it's like 10 minutes before time." And she says, "Can you do the wedding?" Well, you know, in the United Methodist Church, when we prepare to do a wedding ceremony, we're supposed to have the couple do some kind of premarital counseling, some kind of semblance of something. And I said, "Well, Sally, I could, but tell me why justice of the peace and not a minister of some sort?" "Well," she said, "I'm not even sure I believe in God anymore." I said, "Well, if I officiate at the service, I do have to mention God and Jesus. I've got to bring them in a little bit." "Well," she says, "I know. Just please don't overdo it. Please don't overdo it." Well, we did. We had a lovely ceremony. I tried not to overdo it. She was pleased. The family was pleased. But in the years since, it got me to thinking about how we live out our faith and how we display it outside these four walls. Psalm 34 that Amber read earlier says, "Look to God and be radiant, so your faces shall never be ashamed. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are those who take refuge in God." In other words, it should be evident in our worship and in our living, bubbling over, joyful, and so on. Now, I know, we can't always be that way. Personal problems, life pressures, my goodness, situations going on in society around us. I get that. But it seems that too often, expressing our faith outside these walls, we say, "Well, you know, let's not overdo it. Let's not go overboard. We don't want to go too far." And it got me wondering again, where is the bold excitement about the Christian faith? How is the inspiration evident? Where is the energization, if that's even a word, the spirit that gets inside of us and won't let us go? Where is that? I mean, we do deeds of goodness, we do deeds of compassion, we do that very well, but proclaiming in the public square, as it were, witnessing in the community, where, when, and how do we boldly make faith evident? Where, when, and how do we show its relevance to the community, the nation, and the world in which we live? Not too often. That brings me to the second story. The story was when I was in another church, serving a church, and it must have been like Memorial Day or the 4th of July, one of those big patriotic days. Now, I don't normally, well, I never have, picked one of those patriotic hymns for use on any of our national holidays. If we want to keep politics out of the church, then we ought not, I won't use those hymns. But the organist picked Battle Hymn of the Republic as the postlude. It is a patriotic hymn. It's got religious overtones, I get that, but it's still political nonetheless, enlisting God to help in a national cause. The Civil War, as a matter of fact, but that's okay. I mean, a good cause, noble cause. Some may disagree with me, but I would never have picked it. But I have never said to organists or pianists, don't use them either, because I know they work for some people. So, service is over. We're at the postlude. The organist played through the several verses of the hymn, getting louder and more dramatic as she went along, and opened up stop after stop after stop on the organ. People stopped, transfixed, listening, as she rolled on and got more and more powerful. He loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible swift sword. As Christ died to make men holy, let us die to make men free. And the final verse, the chorus, she crescendoed to a rousing, closing, glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on, glory, glory, hallelujah. And she held that last note with all those pipes blowing until she let go and stopped with a flourish. And the crowd, the congregation, stood where they were and clapped and cheered and woo-hooed all through the room. One young man in the front was jumping up and down, his arms waving in the air, clapping and cheering. It was like he was having an ecstatic experience in a camp meeting, starting to jump over the benches. He was so caught up in that moment. And I'm standing in the back watching this, and all this is okay with me. I mean, the hymn doesn't resonate with me in that way, but that's fine. That's fine. Worship isn't always about me. Sometimes that's good, sometimes it's not. I get it. It works for some people. And listen, I'm as patriotic as the next person, all right? My son was born on Flag Day. I don't need to tell you all, but that's June 14th. I was born in Massachusetts on April 19th, so you all know what that means. Yes? Patriots Day, Battle of Bunker Hill, start of the Revolutionary War, government holidays. Schools were, when I was growing up, the holiday was on the day. We were never in school on my holiday, on my birthday. Fun fact. Here in New York State, at least this part of the state, when we send in our federal income tax returns, they go to an address in Massachusetts. And that's why some years, depending on how the calendar goes, we get an extra couple of days beyond April 15th, because in Massachusetts, the government offices are closed. And just for those who want to make a note of it, Patriots Day in 2019 is on a Friday. Just if you want to note that, Amber, you don't. Has nothing to do with me, but Patriots Day, April 19th, Friday, 2019. Well, so indeed, we are enthusiastic about some things in church. That congregation certainly wasn't. That young man was. There are things for which we won't say, oh, don't overdo it. We are quite ready, willing to show our enthusiasm. Okay, fine. Which brings us to church. The reason we're in church, according to Psalm 34, it's to worship, to celebrate, to raise up the God of our creation, to lift up the Christ of our salvation, to become empowered and energized by the Spirit of our sustentation. That, in part, is why we're here. And what better one of the hymns to do that with than How Great Thou Art. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder, consider all the worlds thy hands have made. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation, what joy shall fill my heart? I look down from lofty mountain grandeur. I'm not the most effervescent person, I get that. But even I am having almost a religious experience just reading the words. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art. What do I hear when we sing it in church? O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider, God, how many verses are in this hymn? The world's thy hand. Okay? I don't want to complain. I don't want to be just a grouchy old man. But there is a disconnect that I see anyway. A disconnect. There is unbridled enthusiasm and exuberance for some at some times for some things that aren't necessarily religious. And at other times it's, well, let's not go too far. Let's not overdo it. Too often those are religious things. A woman in this same church, as it happened, said to me one day, pulled me aside, "You should preach fire and brimstone," she said to me. Your sermons are good, they're okay, but you're kind of low-key. You should really tell them what it's all about. Preach about sin and what happens to sinners." Well, I thought I had been all along, but apparently not to her. And I realized if I had preached about the need to go to church regularly, if I had preached about being a good citizen, though that's a political statement, if I had preached about paying support to the church, if I had talked about the sins of lying and cheating and being unfaithful to a loved one and criminal acts and so on, she'd have been right there. She would have been right there, and I would have been okay with her, because that's what she wanted. She did all the good things and none of the bad things. I knew her well enough to know that. I also knew if I had preached about the sin of supporting a tax system that benefits the healthy, the wealthy, and the wise, while denying the poor and the neediest in our midst the most basics of food and shelter and health care, if I had preached about the sin of turning away desperate alien neighbors in need, fleeing for their very lives, wanting only a safe place to live, a healthy place to raise their children and work and grow, the very people that the Bible in the Old and New Testaments call us to serve and to save, if I had preached about the sin of denying the God-given humanity in persons because of their color or their religious faith or who they love or the circumstance of their birth or any other of those things, if I had preached about those sins, she'd have said, "Well, now you've gone too far. You're meddling. You're meddling. And there's no place in church for that. Let's not overdo it." And I get it. I get it. Some truths are not easy to hear. I don't want to hear them. There are times I open the Bible to a suggested passage of the day, and I don't want to read that anymore. I don't want to read that. It's going to cost me something. I don't want to go there because it will cost me something. Like the preacher who said to one of his members, talking about tithing, "If you had 10 wonderful homes, beautiful homes, would you give one to the church? A tenth?" "Oh, absolutely, Pastor. If I had 10, I'd be happy to give one to the church." "Well, if you had 10 fancy cars, expensive automobiles, would you donate one to the church so, you know, we could sell it and use the money for our ministries?" "Absolutely, I would do that." "If you had $10,000, would you give a tenth to the church?" And the man said, "Well, that's not fair. You know I have $10,000. The Christian faith requires, expects something of us. Having Jesus in our lives makes a difference, doesn't it? Or it ought to. It ought to. The question is, how do we show it? How do we live it? How do we not keep it under a bushel? Blind Bartimaeus regains his sight. He received the gift of sight in his eyes. But he also received the sight to see the world as God in Jesus Christ wants it to be seen, where the holy comes in varieties of sizes and shapes and colors and hues and interests and loves and beliefs and likes and dislikes, abilities and capabilities, all united as a part of a good and glorious creation under a good and gracious God, revealed in the life and the death and the resurrection of a selfless Savior, and instilled in us anew each day, if we allow it, by a Holy Spirit of holy presence. That's what Bartimaeus saw when he got his sight. May we see it too. And may we live it with vim, with verve, and with enthusiasm, with a spirit that pushes aside the human inclination to not overdo. And may we instead embrace the gifts of serving God in Jesus Christ with anticipation with joy, with thanksgiving, overflowing in abundance, given freely to any and to all in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.